tonight's show, I'm joined by musician Rusty Appy, comedian Sam Serrano, and filmmaker Jay Cunningham. Don't go anywhere, roll titles. Thank you for coming, thank you for tuning in for another episode of Friday Night with Dean Aldridge. If you are watching and it's Friday night and it's 9 o'clock, I know the last thing you want to be doing is looking at my ugly mush, but if you are watching, thank you so much. Keep liking, keep subscribing, keep sharing, and most of all, please donate to our Just Giving page. We are trying to put a little bit of money back into the local food banks. I got arrested this week. A police officer, he caught me doing donuts in my car. Now I know what you're thinking, who calls the dog donuts? I'm joking. God, you want to see the faces in here? Guys, I'm not going to keep you waiting. This week, your musician is Rusty Appy, and he's singing his song One Last Time. Guys, it's Rusty Appy. Rusty, thank you for coming on. I love the song, mate.
Brilliant. Thank you very much.
Different to what we've had on the show previously, so thank you, mate. Thank you for taking some time off.
Bit of variety for you.
Yeah, that's what we like.
Why not?
Trying to appeal to everyone.
Yeah. I appreciate it. Thanks for having me.
Rusty, tell us a little bit about your little music journey. Your little music journey. It's not a little music journey, I bet. Yeah. I bet you've been going for a while.
Yeah, I feel like an old man. I feel like, oh, am I really still doing this? No, it's been cool. It's been great. I started out in a few bands and, I started out as a drummer and, I think like anyone does, you get to a point where you feel like, I just want to do kind of what I want to do and that, have a bit more control over it. So that was when I started writing songs. And yeah, I mean, it wasn't really because of the lockdown, but I just felt like the songs were there and it was time to do another album. So
brilliant. So the song we've just heard then, and I know you're performing another one tonight for us, they're not actually out at the moment, are they?
Not yet. I'm hoping it'll be out kind of late summer, but I don't want to rush it.
Yeah. But I've got other stuff across platforms.
Oh yeah, so I'm on Spotify. This is going to be my fourth album, I think.
Fourth album, yeah. Nice. How's it going? How's music going for you?
You know what? I love it. Yeah. And I've been really, you know, I don't want to say lucky, because I always encourage people who work hard not to say they're lucky, you know. But I've been blessed, you know what I mean? I've had amazing musicians. I've been in some really nice projects, and I've been fortunate enough to sort of tour all over. I even managed to tour last year. Just before COVID hit. So I was like one of the really lucky ones. So yeah. So it's just nice to be writing music again, do you know what I mean? And coming up with fresh stuff.
Where's your favourite venue that you performed at?
Oh my goodness. Well, trying to keep it kind of close to home. The reason why I moved to Liverpool, one of the reasons, there was a few reasons. One of the reasons why was I was on tour with my old band, and we played at the Cavern. And I was just like, I'd never been to Liverpool before, and I just loved it. I just loved the city and the people and everything. So after leaving that band, when I went back to being solo again, after I moved to Liverpool, we did a gig where we opened for Big Country at the Cavern, and it was sold out. And it was just, and there's so many great venues, you know, and they've all suffered recently because of like COVID and things like that. So it's really hard to pick. But, you know,
that one sticks out the most.
Shout out for Liverpool. It's a Cavern, isn't it? It's just special. It's just something about it. You know, it's in the walls. So, yeah.
Brilliant. Yeah. So away from music, obviously, you've got your success there, but you're also into filmmaking as well, aren't
you? Yeah, yeah.
You've got a new film coming out.
Yeah, yeah. There's a new film working on at the minute, which is I would like to say around 85% complete. And it's got mostly Liverpool cast and crew and stuff like that, and it's a horror anthology, so it's different horror stories, and it's called Artifacts of Fear. And
I believe we've actually got a quick trailer on it. Just take a look at this.
Some tales are told, then soon forgotten. But legends last forever.
You have to understand that these are not stories, it's all real. It has been around for centuries, and it feeds. These things people experience, the nightmares, the sleepwalking, the waking up at exactly 3:33 every morning. See, the hour itself is known as the devil's hour, and that number, 333, that's one half of the answer, that's symbolic. The answer is 666. Now, its power happens in three stages, you need to understand this. The first, a presence is felt. The second, the taking of the soul. And the third, total possession.
From the mind of Rusty Apper comes a terrifying new vision. Three tales to blacken your soul. Artifacts of Fear. Coming soon.
Brilliant, mate. It looks outstanding, do you know what I mean? It's a horror, clearly.
There you go.
Put the shits up the locals.
I've always been taught, just make sure people know exactly what you're trying to do straight away. Don't confuse people. Just go, this is what it is. And it's the same with the music. I try to just be authentic, do you know what I mean? And when it goes back to the film thing, I just think about what I loved when I was younger, watching horror films and stuff. It's fun, isn't it? Do you know what I mean? It's great fun.
And I'll be honest with you, I'm not a fan of horror films.
Are you not?
I am still a shitbag. Like, Halloween H2O, I dream about Mike Myers for about 3 months afterwards. I can't stand it. They scared the shit out of me. I watched The Meg from behind my couch.
Well,
it's not even a scary film. It's about a shark, do you know what I mean? I just ate jumpy bits.
Yeah. But you know what? It's one of those things that I miss about being a kid big time, is being that freaked out by just films and things. And I always say to anyone who says, oh no, I can't watch horror films because they're terrifying, I'm like, we need people like you. You know, we need people to be freaked out, because so many people are like, I don't want to watch that, it's too low budget, oh it's not scary, or you can see the guy's mask or whatever, and it's just like, just enjoy it.
I'm literally that person when like people go, oh we're going to Farmageddon, you're coming, I'm like, oh shit, really? I'm thinking, no, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I don't want to go there.
There is something about that when people are actually grabbing you in your face. Yeah. It's like, oh, it's not even a movie. It's like, anything could happen.
Petrifying, yeah. So, just out of the two of them, which you prefer, is it making music or making films?
You can't do that to me, Dean.
I've got it.
You can't.
Got it's on the spot, you know, it's for the viewers.
That's for the people. It's for the people, isn't it? why have you done this to me? I would say music is a little bit more gratifying. You get more gratification quicker, and it's a little bit easier. Making a film, you know, there's so much that goes into it, you know.
I can see how hard it was for you to decide that.
It was seriously hard.
You've got a balance of love for both. Rusty, yeah. Thank you for coming on, mate.
Thank you.
Obviously, you're playing another song for us. What's that called?
It's a new one, Understanding Love.
Understanding Love. Guys, stick around for that and make sure you support Rusty and everything he's doing. Thank you very much, mate.
Thank you. Cheers.
So my next guest is the king and queen of comedy. It's Mr. Samuel Serrano. If you're not familiar with his work, here's a little clip of him in action.
I had one person come over to me the other day and she went, "You were fucking disgusting." I went, "Excuse me?" She went, "You were vile on that stage pretending you've got learning difficulties." I was like, "Oh no, I'm not pretending. I've got something called Kabuki syndrome. It's a bit like autism." And then she put a finger on my lips and went, no, "I know you don't have learning difficulties." I was like, "You're not my fucking doctor, how do you know?" She went, "I know you don't have learning difficulties because I've just seen you talk for 10 minutes, so you're not properly disabled, are you?" Which I know sounds really bad, but I think it's the most supportive thing my mum's ever said to me.
Ladies and gents, it's Sam Serrano.
Hello.
How you doing, mate?
I'm all right, how are you?
Thank you for coming on, Sam. It's always a pleasure to see you, mate. We were talking then off camera. It's been at least 18 months since we last seen each other, something like that.
It's been ages, man.
Tell us a little bit about you, Sam, for those who don't know you. Tell us a little bit how you got into comedy, your journey growing up and stuff like that.
Well, I started comedy when I was 14, which I think is too far too... I should have been fucking fingering people behind bins at that age, like not telling jokes in pubs. But I started that and then I took a bit of time off for my GCSEs, which I think is what everyone takes time off comedy, innit? I started getting back into it. So I say I've been going since I was 18. So about 3 years. Mm. Well, if the gig goes bad, I say it's my first gig. I'm like, oh yeah,
there's an ongoing joke that you seem to be like 17 forever in comedy, isn't it? It's like a big thing on the circuit.
How long 17 for?
Yeah. So when you're saying you started when you were 14, mm-hmm. was this comedy clubs?
Yeah, I did my first gig was at a non-alcoholic bar in town called The Brink, because it was the only place that would let a 14-year-old do comedy.
Yeah, yeah.
And then I did the hot water comedy course, so Paul Smith taught me how to do comedy, so if you think I'm shit, blame him.
No one thinks you shit, don't Sam. I mean, since I've been doing comedy myself, I've not been going that long, but you've got your reputation behind you is ridiculously
good,
mate. Tell us a little bit about the gig you're seeing here at the comedy store. Like, that must have been...
Oh, that was mental. Yeah. Really, really good fun, that one. So it was a new material night, and I was like, I just said to the MC, I was like, "You are aware this is one of the first times I've ever done the comedy call?" And he went, "Yeah," and I went, "I'm not fucking doing new material. I'm not going on with the notes. I'm doing my top like 10 bits." And he went, "Yeah, that's sound." So I went on and did well. And then I came off and Sarah Millican and Gary Delaney were just backstage. And I didn't realise they'd watched me.
Right.
And they came over and went, "Oh, we really liked your stuff. Would you like a drink?" And I went, "Yeah, please." And then they left to get me a drink.
Wow.
And then the security guard came in and went, "Oh, Sam, your girlfriend's fallen downstairs. You need to go to the hospital with her." So I never got that drink off Sarah Millican.
Oh my God.
How
did you take that with your girlfriends? Was little sitting there in A&E fuming?
We broke up 3 days later.
I bet you did, yeah.
Might have been linked.
Messaging Gary Delaney. "I'm sorry about that, God." So we obviously... You come from gender fluid. That explains you perfectly, Sam. So what have you found doing comedy? What's it been like bringing that into comedy? Because you do joke about it a lot, don't you?
Yeah, I talk about it a lot. It's partly because I think it needs to be spoken. I think a big thing for me is growing up, I didn't have that representation. I didn't know gender fluid was a thing.
Yeah.
I just thought I was fucked. You know, I just thought something was wrong with me.
Yeah.
So I'm like, I need to be the person which like little Sam would have wanted to see. And it's also my agent going, Sam, fucking talk about it more so I can get money off the BBC. Very much my agent's queer cash cow in this scenario. But yeah, I talk about it a lot. And you kind of, you get a bit of backlash, but then you also get times where you're like, oh no, I am on the right tracks. Like I was gonna do, I was buying some makeup in Primark, and I went to the front desk and the scandal through it, and the woman just went, oh, do you do comedy? I went, yeah, I do. She went, oh, we saw you at Hot Water a few weeks ago. And my child is gender fluid, and the dad's never really been accepting us all. They don't use the right pronouns. Yeah. They don't do this. But since they've seen you, they've kind of been a lot more accepting. And I think that was the first time when I was like, oh, no, this is, I'm doing, like, something good here. Yeah, this is the right thing.
That recognition must have felt great, mate. To get that little feedback, like, and obviously you're opening the eyes of people as you do it as well, because I'll be honest with you, Sam, when I first met you and like I heard about gender fluid, I'm like a lot of people, I didn't understand it at first. It's like, what is there to understand as well at the same time? It's an acceptance, isn't it? So
yeah, definitely. Like I always think this when we go, oh, I don't understand it, I was like, yeah, it, I didn't come out until I was 18. It took me 18 years to understand it. We're not going to understand it in a 3-minute conversation in Starbucks, you know. But yeah, it's like, I think because it's something which has been around for ages. Like the first time it's mentioned is like Plato has mentioned it in like ancient Greece and all this mad shit. And so it's always been it. It's just been under different labels and different kind of just been hidden in different ways, and I think it's like, I think there are more and more people getting accepting, and like, I always think like, if 10 years ago someone went on stage and like did jokes about black people, it would be like, people would laugh, and people were like, oh, there's nothing wrong with that. Now if you go on and do jokes about black people, it's frowned upon. And if people go on stage now and joke about, oh, gender fluid people, oh, trans people, it'll get a laugh. But the same thing will happen. It'll be a full circle. In 10 years' time, people go, oh, fuck off. That's not nice. You're not allowed to say that. Yeah. Sorry, did I kick you then?
You did, Dan. I'm so sorry. I don't know whether it was because of the question I asked you or what. I just accepted it. I was like, stop talking about that, dude. So, have you got much lined up in comedy gigs wise? I know you're doing one for me at the end of June, but I am.
We're working on, I've got my hour coming up sometime in June for Bradford Comedy Festival, and then we're looking to get loads more in just around the country, because I think like,
how's preparing for that being doing an hour?
Oh, I've been doing work in progress for a while, so getting a show that I'm kind of, that I'm happy with, and I'm like, yeah, this is what I wanted to say with it, has been like a huge kind of issue. Yeah. I think it's been like a tricky thing for me to go, what do I actually want to talk about in this full hour of comedy? And I think I've got it right. You might speak to me after the first few dates and I'll go, nope, it's complete shit.
I don't think I've seen you do a bad gig, Sam. I really haven't. And
How many times have you seen me?
Not a lot, mate. I've been at some gigs where I weren't even performing myself, and you've smashed it, mate.
Oh,
so,
thank you, man. Thank you very much.
Yeah, that, I mean, you're ass smashing it, keep up the weight, you know what I mean? And obviously, away from comedy, I hope, you know, you're finding your happiness as well, mate. How's things now, relationship-wise? All good?
Yeah, they're all good. I've got, I'm in a relationship with, she's down in London, so it's long distance, which can be, like, it can be quite hard because we don't get to see each other a lot, but, like, they can be, like, that's, like, it's got benefits as well, like, it's dead easy to cheat on her, you know, like you don't have to kind of hide your phone and stuff. Like, honestly, if anyone out there looking to cheat, I'd suggest long distance. You don't see them for about 6 months at a time. It's brilliant.
You're gonna get everyone in trouble. So anyone who's in a long distance relationship just looked at the partner and gone,
Sam, they just texted the partner.
Thank you very much for coming on, mate.
Thank you very much for having
guest
me.
And I hope to get you back on soon, okay?
I'd love to.
Take it easy. Thank Sam Serrano, ladies and gents. So my final guest this evening is writer, producer and director. It's Jay Cunningham, ladies and gents. Jay, thank you for coming, mate.
Hey, Dean, thanks very much, mate, for having me.
Jay, you've got a new film out soon.
Tell us all about it, mate.
So the film is called Jones, or everybody else knows it as J1S.
Even myself included. Take 10.
Yeah. And the film is essentially a story about our over-reliance on technology. And for me, it's a warning. So are we too reliant on it right now? Phones have crept into our lives. We're spending more time on them. We're surrounding ourselves with technology. So that's the sort of the reason why I did the film. Mm. But the film itself is essentially Jekyll and Hyde with Scousers and Robots in Liverpool.
Nice. Yeah. So obviously Liverpool, when you hear about films getting made in Liverpool, it's normally gangsters and action films. Why go down sci-fi? Obviously you touched on it there, but what are you more into sci-fi films? Is that you or?
No, I like all sorts of films, but I think that I've seen loads of gangster films made in Liverpool, and I thought I want to do something different. I want it, we're calling it Scouse Fight, right? So it's Scousers doing sci-fi. Yeah. I was put up at South by Southwest in Austin, in Texas, with the Put Great Back in Britain campaign. And I was talking on that in my accent and had some clips of the film, and some of the Americans contacted me and said, oh, we like the concept of the film, but why are people talking in this accent? Why can't they talk like us? So I'm going to swear now. I thought, fuck you. I'm going to do... That made me want to do the film even more. Fuck. So, yeah. Scousers, sci-fi, robots. Why not in Liverpool?
Brilliant. So have you got anything else in future? Obviously, this one you're sending off to festivals, film festivals and stuff like that.
So it's going to festivals around the world. We'll see what happens. Again, film is art, isn't it? So people will either love it or hate it, or somewhere in the middle. I've got three more films wrote. The film Jones ends on a particular point, which means I can probably do two more films after it. So I shot it on a shoestring, and what I want to do is to say to people, here's the story. Give us a few more quid, please, so we can make it bigger and better.
Bigger budget.
Yeah. Everybody wants a bigger budget, yeah.
I like it. So when you're filming and you're doing stuff like that, which side of the camera do you prefer to be on? Is it this one or...?
Not this one. No, I don't like being here. I definitely prefer to be there. And I've done a master's in screenwriting, so I've always had ideas in my head. And I was always sending off to competitions and nobody was giving me money, so it's probably either the scripts were shit or they just couldn't be bothered. So I thought, you know what, sod it, I'm going to make my own films and go my own way.
It seems to be becoming more of a common thing. Not a lot of people just going and doing my own thing, you know. And obviously a few weeks back we had John May on and he's done the same thing. He's just put his own foot down and he's just making his own path. And
I think people have more platforms. So if you go back years ago, real film was expensive. It was expensive to use. It was expensive if you got the shots wrong, and it was expensive to get it flipped into the film that we see on the cinema. Whereas digital is easier, you know. You can roll, you can stop, you can delete your card, you can go again. So I think that's given people more platforms. Facebook, Instagram, and you know, people have got literally a cinema in their hand. People can watch what they want in their hand or any time of the day. Gone are the days of Channel 1, 2 and 3, right? For those of you who are as old as me, you might remember that.
So, obviously, Liverpool's got a lot coming in like the region of filmmaking and stuff like that. Budget-wise, how big can you see filmmaking in Liverpool going?
I think Liverpool's massive. Number one, because, you know, there's a load of talent here anyway. The buildings look like London or New York or, you know, many other major cities in the world, so I think a lot of people are interested for that. I mean, I was watching Aquaman the other day and I seen the chimneys off the tunnels on it, and I was like, how the fuck are the chimneys off the Mersey in Aquaman? So, yeah, I think everyone's here all the time filming, but it's a boss city. It's got a great waterfront. It's got amazing architecture.
We're leaving that in, by the way. Yeah,
architecture. And also, I think it's got people, Scousers, are just willing to get shit done.
Yeah.
So I think, yeah, it's all coming together.
Definitely. If you had to choose one actor, dead or alive, who would it be to be in your film?
Oh, shit.
Preferably not shit.
Christian Bale.
Christian fan?
I like Christian Bale, yeah.
Nice.
It'd be great.
Jay, thank you for coming on, mate. I really appreciate your time. I know this was a short and sweet interview, mate, but obviously we can't wait to see your film. Do you want to tell us when it's out?
So the film is going to festivals, so I can't show it to anyone right now, because if I do, I'll get thrown out the festivals. So as soon as it's done a little run, I want to put it on in town. And what I would love to do is people come and watch it, and then I'll donate the money to some charities in Liverpool. So I won't take the money myself, but I will give the money back to charity. So yeah, thanks.
No worries, guys. Jay Cunningham, thank you very much.
Thank you. Cheers.
Now to end the show, it's Rusty Appert with his new single, Understanding Love.
Love is like